Hi, slowly we are approaching the end of the semester, and maybe now is time, because we are electrical engineering, it's time to talk about embedded systems and how we can program embedded systems in C. In the third year, if you want, you can join the machine learning class, and there we have these exercise boards that I have in my hand right now. So on the exercise board, there are several of integrated chips, integrated circuits. So this first one is the CPU of our exercise board. It's a very ancient chip, an 8051 microprocessor, 8-bit microprocessor. But in this case, this microprocessor is designed as a composed programming unit, and the program memory is also there, and also some random access memory, RAM, several kilobytes, and so on. And so this chip alone is something like our own computer, and we can program this computer as we see just today in C. And then down there are multipurpose I/O chips on this exercise board, and with this multipurpose I/O chips I can control LEDs, an array here of 8 LEDs with one port, and I have another port where I can read out if any of these four buttons has been pushed. So in the third year we are going to learn how to program these things in machine language, but we can also program them in C, and the C compiler is going to translate these programs into machine language, and we don't need any operating system. We directly access what registers. So these are basically little hardware units that look like computer memory and that have actually some function. It is a very important thing in digital electronics. So let's do it now. Okay, let's try first to understand how these multipurpose I/O chips work. The name of this type of chip is 8255, and the current implementation that is on this exercise board that I use for the microprocessor class is 82C55. And maybe this side is not so interesting for us. This is basically how the computer works with these chips. Here, this side shows the ports that can be individually programmed for input or output. And there, basically, we see here 24 lines, and they are organized in three groups. Each of these groups contains 8 lines. So, and we can imagine 8 lines, well, that's something like 8 bits. So, basically, with one byte of computer memory, we can control this port. So we can basically write a number into some memory cell that is actually a register, and this number is then transferred in active line or inactive line. So one of these lines has either 5 volt or 0 volt. For example, if we write the number 1 to this register, this means that this line number 0 is 1 and all of the other lines are 0. Or we write 2, then this line is 0 and the next line is 1 and all other lines are 0. Or if we write a value 255 or in hexadecimal numbers FF, then all the lines are 1 and so on. Yeah, so we can imagine how that works. And then we have the same situation for the port B. And then we have also a third port, port C. We can also use these ports not for write to the outside world, but also to read from the inside world. So basically, maybe we connect this port to 5 volt power supply, then this means this bit is 1, and maybe we connect all the other pins here to 0 volt, to ground, then this means we have here 1000, so this means we have the value 1 in the corresponding register. And so on. So we can use also these ports for reading values, and that is exactly what happens if we use these buttons. So by default, the 8255 that we are going to use right now is programmed, or is going to be programmed, to be for output for the port A and to be input for the port B. The port A is connected to LEDs, so these LEDs are going to light up if we send a 1 to one of these pins. So for example, if we set the value 1, then this LED that is connected to this pin will light up and all the other LEDs remain dark. And then we have here on the port B, for the first 4 of these pins, they are connected to these buttons, and the buttons connect these pins either to 0 volt or to 5 volt. So this will be a 1 or a 0 depending on how we configure our ports. Okay, so here is now a little program, and maybe you realize that most of this program is really written in something like C. Yeah, we are maybe familiar here with the main function. So here is basically what should be executed after we start. In this case, not the program, but the whole board. We're going to see how that works. You push a button and then you start the program on this exercise board. Then we have here another function delay, and then inside is something with which we are not familiar. This code is actually assembly. Yeah? This is something that is very near to the machine language, that is a language that is the language that is directly understood by a central processing unit, a microprocessor. And then in the first 3 lines, we have definitions of global variables. And these definitions, they look very special, and they are in fact very special. So that's a very special thing to this particular dialect of C. I should say that C, with regard to embedded systems, so the big keyword here is embedded system. We have here a microcontroller, and basically for every particular microcontroller, either the manufacturer or some other interested people, they provide an own C compiler that can handle this particular microprocessor. And then often this particular C processor has some special features that are not used in other microprocessors. And so there are special features in this language that are not common in the C world, but you have to learn them for every particular dialect of this C. And that is in particular true for what we see here. So what you should see here is basically here a variable name. That is, so this variable is defined as a global variable. It's not defined in any function here, so this is a global variable. Then we know in C we always need to say what is the type of this particular variable, and the type is an unsigned character in this case. I mentioned already that registers of this multipurpose I/O chip, they are bytes. So the size of a byte is 8 bits, and the size of an unsigned character is also 1 byte, and that is 8 bits. So if we want to translate features of a register, we need to say, okay, this is not an integer variable, this is not a floating point variable or a long variable, this is an unsigned character. So we could also define it as a signed character, of course, but then we need to consider negative numbers, positive numbers. So it's by far the most convenient way to say it's an unsigned character. So this is exactly the size of 1 byte. Then we have here another keyword, and that is actually pretty standard in C. It is the keyword volatile. And this has a very peculiar meaning. This means this variable can be changed by other means than the program. Yeah. So normally if we define a variable in C, on the inside the program this variable can be changed. Yeah. So we have maybe a function here, main function, and then we say port P, this variable name P82C55_port_A should be equal to 25 or something like this, and this is the moment this variable is changed, yeah, and it cannot be changed by any other means than inside our program. However, if we deal with these kind of registers that are on the chip, this can be influenced by the hardware. Yeah, so the hardware can be connected. Some hardware can be connected to this multipurpose I/O chip, and then this can have an influence on the state of this register. And this means the value of this variable can be changed even if there's nothing in the program that changes the value of this variable. So this should be indicated by the keyword volatile. And then we have here basically this underbar add. This is now a very special thing of this particular dialect in C. This should indicate that this variable here should be located at some position in the computer memory. And this position is the address A000. So I should mention here that this microprocessor that we're using uses a 64 kilobyte address space. And this A00 is a very typical address inside this 64 kilobyte address space. Is a hexadecimal number, and this hexadecimal number coincides with the address that this register of our multipurpose I/O chip has in the address space of the microprocessor of the exercise board that we use here. So we have here this address, then we have the next variable here. This is the address of the register that deals with the port B. This is actually the next address in the memory space. And then we have here a configuration register. We later see how that works, or I just tell you right now. Then we have here also a keyword that is very particular for this C dialect, for this microprocessor, the 8051 microprocessor. This means this memory address is in the external data space. So this microprocessor has three different data space, or even more than that. And every one of these address spaces has a own name. And the one that we're using here is the external data. So here we have the keyword xdata used. Okay, so far so good. We have here now these three global variables that are actually represent registers of the multipurpose I/O chip. Now we come to the main function that is here. And here I should say this main function is always called after the reset button of the exercise board is pushed. So this means after the reset button is pushed, the board kind of goes through something like a boot process in the computer, and this takes some time. So all the hardware is not available immediately after the boot starts, after we push the reset button, so we have to wait for some period of time. And because this is the case, we have to go through some delay. It doesn't matter how long the delay is, it has just to be some time, else the chips won't work. Yeah. So here we go through a delay of milliseconds, and the milliseconds are as a hexadecimal number 89. Just some arbitrary delay. And then after that, we configure our multipurpose I/O chip. I mentioned already we can configure this chip in different ways. So one way to configure the chip is to say the port A, that is the port that is connected to the LEDs, should be set to output, and the port B, that is the port that is connected to the buttons, should be set to input, And all of these different configurations, they can be put together in one number. And this number in this case is the number A2 hexadecimal. So we can set the configuration register, which is this variable here. We can set this configuration register to the value A2 hexadecimal. And after we have done that, we can write to the LEDs, for example, also with a delay, we can increment this register value of the LEDs, and then we see how the LEDs turn on and off. And we want to do that forever, so we say here while one, basically while true, and one is forever true, so this will go on forever. We have a delay here, and then we increment the port A value, and yeah, we will never finish with that. If the port A value reaches the highest possible value for an unsigned character number, the register will start from zero again. This is basically part of the definition here. So this will go on forever, and we will never reach this point where we return anything here. This return can also be left out. It's just here to avoid a warning message from the compiler. Okay, so now we compile this little program. We get here two warnings, and there we see this compiler is really smart. It says warning 126 unreachable code for the line 31. Let's have a look what that means. The line 31 is down there. So it says really that the return statement is never reached. We can also leave that out then. In this case, and we can save it again. Okay, and now we compile it. We get here one warning, and that relates to the delay function. That is a little bit hard to understand. We have here a machine code, and the machine code takes here this argument basically as a input on how long the delay should be. And if you look on this particular compiler, how this code is translated from C into machine language, you find out that this register A is translated into this DPL. The argument here, the argument A, is translated into, is moved into the DPL register. So the value that is put here by the programmer is by the compiler then transferred to the register DPL. So we get here a warning, but nothing is wrong, so we don't need to worry about that. The next step is that we upload this program into the exercise board. Okay, we have here the compiler result, and we know this is a binary file. Let's have a look how this actually is organized here. So we see after the compilation process we have all these files here that most of them are produced by the compiler. So actually the original C program is this one here, and the compiler produces out of the C program assembly program. That's basically this intermediate step to the machine language. So here this is the assembly program. Then we have here demo1.ihx, and this is a machine language description that can be transferred to the exercise board. So this is the essential result of the compilation process. We need to copy this for some particular reasons. We need to copy that into one file that's called out.hex. Okay, and then we can upload it to the exercise board that is connected to this PC via a USB cable. So this is some special uploader program that is written in Python. And I need to push the reset button maybe one more time. And we see now this program is uploaded. And we push the reset button one more time, and I can show you the running program. Okay, and what you should see here is are these moving LEDs, yeah, down there. So basically this is how counting works inside bytes. We see here the fastest flickering LED belongs to the bit 0. So it's basically always going on and off with the highest frequency. Then we see the next bit has a much lower frequency and so on. And basically we go through all the numbers between 0 and 255 in binary encoding. Okay, we can also modify our program and see what other configuration we can organize with the LEDs, and maybe we can also integrate the button. Okay, maybe first, before we do these modifications, briefly we can also talk a little bit more about here this delay function. We see here inside we see this underbar ASM and underbar end ASM. And this is what is called in the context of a C compiler inline assembly. Sometimes it's necessary to include very native machine instructions into C code. For example, if we program extended functionality for our central processing unit, something like interrupts, for example, then this cannot be covered just by C code. So there has to be some part, maybe turning off the interrupt capabilities and turning them on later or stuff like that. That is not provided in C in many cases. So we have to have some little parts that are actually assembly code. And this, of course, also true here. Yeah. So if you want to learn the details about this part here, you need to go to my microprocessor class in the third year. Okay, let's go then into the main function. We want to change a little bit the pattern of our LEDs. For example, we want to have a shifting LED light. This can be also be done. We initialize our LED array in the way that the utmost right LED is light up and then the other LEDs are turned off. Yeah, so this can be done in this way. We set the port LED A value to 1, and then what we can do is we can say here port LED is equal to 2 times port A. So if we multiply the current value of port A by 2, this means that we, so for example, we start with 1. If you multiply this 1 by 2, it becomes 2. And if we imagine this number as a binary number, this is actually 1, 0. And if you multiply by 2 again, then the resulting binary number, the resulting number would be 4. As a binary number, this would be 1, 0, 0, and so on. So the next one would be 8, 1, 0, 0, 0, and so on. So we see in this way we can shift our LED to the left side. Okay, I save that now and I compile that with our SDCC compiler. I have to copy again and upload. And now we can see, if I push now the reset button, that we have this moving light 1 time. Like every iteration that we do here, our value is multiplied by 2. Now it doesn't work anymore. Maybe only 1 time. Okay, let's try out to make it repetitive. And of course we can make it repetitive by starting something like a for loop. For example, we could say here 4. I plus plus, yeah, we start with 0 and we go to 7, maybe smaller than 8. And then we go here. And here, and every time, of course, we have to initialize our port A to be 1. So maybe the easiest is if I copy, I cut this here and I put it into the area of the while loop. I can save that and I can compile it. And I copy it. Upload it. And here we can see the effect. Yeah, we see here the moving LED. Okay, finally we can also implement the button control. There we can remove many of these parts that we have here. And we just say port A should be equal to port B. So we just assign the value of port B, that would be the input configured port of our I/O chip that is connected to the buttons with the LEDs. And even we don't necessarily need this delay here. We could also remove that, but maybe try it out now with the delay for the moment. Compile it again and copy and upload. There we are. And now we can run the program. I push the reset button one more time. And now if I push one of these buttons here, this will turn off one of the LEDs. Actually, it's a little bit different from what I told you. Actually, if I push the button, this connects the corresponding pin to the ground of port B. Yeah, and this results in the value 0 in the port B, and then the value of port B is copied to port A. Okay, so far about this little introduction about C in embedded systems. I hope you enjoyed it and we meet later in our live discussion. I hope I can start it on time. Okay, see you then.